15 years of work experience in diverse areas of verticals such as manufacturing, service, media, telecom, retail, pharma, and education. Prior to JetSmart mandate, he has worked with reputed organizations like TNS India and NFO, MBL, and served clients across UK, France, and Asia-Pacific region. His primary responsibility is to architect the solution for the data-driven problems using statistical methods, machine learning, and deep learning algorithm for both structured and unstructured data. Dr. Venugopal Rao Garu expertise lies in understanding of mathematical and statistical theories, experimenting with new technologies, and innovative use of theory in the field of analytics. He has been successfully managing a sincere and dedicated team of analysts at JetSmart mandate on data science using tools like R and Python, others. Additionally, he conducted training sessions on predictive analysis, data mining, and data science concepts and technologies. And also, he has vast experience in surgical software such as SPSS, SAS, SAS, and data processing softwares like Quantum and Wincross. Dr. Venugopal Rao Garu holds a PhD in 2012, MPhil in 2008 from Usman University, Hyderabad. The focus of his PhD was on artificial intelligence and machine learning methods. And his MPhil thesis focused on multivariate analysis application in business and research. He is also a member of Board of Studies as an industry expert for few of autonomous colleges of Usmania University. We honor to have you here on this occasion. Now I request Dr. Venugopal Rao Garu to deliver his lecture.
Yeah. Thank you, madam. Thank you, Jitender sir, for introducing me to the students. Hi, students. Firstly, I wanted to say happy Statistics Day to all, and it's always pleasure to be part of VNR Vijnan Jyoti College. It's my pleasure too. So let me share my screen. Just give me 1 minute. Sorry, students. So yeah. To get the content.
There has never been a better time for artificial intelligence. With big data, cloud, and seamless connectivity, digital voice assistants, smart robotic devices, real-time navigation, the world is ready to explore the potential of this single largest technology disruptor. From defense, healthcare, agriculture, education, transportation, space, the impact of AI has augmented human capabilities to a massive extent. Artificial intelligence for Atmanirbhar Bharat.
Technology opens an entirely new sphere and sector for growth. It also opens an entirely new paradigm opportunities.
Artificial intelligence is all set to contribute and $967 billion to India's economy by 2035. India projects a tremendous potential to be the next big hub for the experimentation, testing, and development of AI technology. Besides the abundance of talent and latest technologies, India has the rich reserve of public data, which together are the growth drivers in AI investments and innovations. For the economy's explosive growth and inclusive social empowerment through AI-assisted healthcare facilities, real-time advisory, smart education, and infrastructure. Welcome to India, a garage for artificial intelligence-powered products and services.
So with this context in mind, India is going to be the garage for the future industry, AI. So madam, you can see my PPT now?
Yes, sir. I think you're presenting your screen. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Now you can see my PPT, correct?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah.
You can put it on full screen, sir.
Yeah, now it's okay, madam?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Yeah, I think with this short video in your mind with that context, let's start the today discussion. By seeing that video, you yourself, you know, had an opportunity to see what is going to be the future of India. So as it is mentioned that your future is going to be with AI, and India is going to be the hub for various reasons, because we have like full of data and we have a lot of skill. So firstly, I think you all have bright future, I think, because you are all anyway starting your journey in the field of data science. So with that context in mind, this is what I am going to talk around next one hour. So I am going to talk about what is the present status, why we should learn, get into the data science. And we also see some of the past and present trends, what was analytics, how it was and how it is now, how it is going to be in the future. And we'll also see how industry is getting transformed with these latest solutions. And finally, one of the important piece, how to set a career towards it and how to build your career to get into this beauty of data science world. And if time permits, we can also take the Q&A. And I want to congratulate you all the students, because you have chosen the path for this great data science field, whether you are AI, ML or cyber security, whatever it may be, because future is full of data. You must also heard that data is oil, data is electricity, data is soil, data is food. Yes, all these are true, because as an industry person, I am seeing, applications on various industries with the data. So yes, you are in right path. So with this, let's start. So if you see the present world, the world is changing very dynamically and exponentially than ever before. I mean, if you see the technology is exponentially growing. Even this COVID further accelerated this technology change. But humans are not growing that much linearly. Hence, there is a huge gap between the technology and humans. So because of this disruption, this technology changes, we have two types of situations emerge. One is two news. One is the good news or one is the bad news. The bad news is that because of this technology disruption, we are losing most of the existing jobs. By virtue of automation, by virtue of artificial intelligence, today we are losing some of the existing jobs. You know, the slight difference between the artificial intelligence and automation, I will tell you. If something in repetitive nature, so what people will try to do, people will try to create some kind of tools or some kind of functions, they used to automate the things. That's basically will happen most of the jobs which are in operational nature. So this automation is there in earlier also. So there also we have seen that some of the jobs, we are losing some of the jobs. But off late, what happened by virtue of artificial intelligence? So what is artificial intelligence? Creating an intelligent system which works with some kind of, creating a system which works with the intelligence. So by virtue of artificial intelligence, this threat even now coming for white collar jobs also. So the jobs required with the minimum intelligent jobs are also getting automated. So by automation, we are most of the operational jobs which are getting automated, that mostly affected the blue collar jobs. Now by virtue of artificial intelligence, even the same threat is coming for, white collar jobs also. So because the systems can work with intelligence, even the threat is coming for some of the jobs which require minimum kind of intelligence also. Those kinds are also jobs are getting automated. So the take is basically, with the technology disruption, yes, there are some jobs which are getting, we are losing some of the jobs which required operational and the jobs which required minimum intelligence kind of jobs. So that is the negative news of it. But what is the positive side of it? Because now we are creating a lot of tools and a lot of AI tools, which is basically augmenting the humans. So their jobs are getting created, which required to create these kind of AI and ML applications. So if you see, there are a lot of jobs are getting created in virtual AR, VR, AR space, robotic space, AI, ML case. So the jobs are required to create these kind of roles, these kind of tools. So hence, So your voice is coming. So can I continue? Hello? Yeah. Am I audible, madam?
Says yes, sir. Sorry yes, for that.
So the jobs which are these kind of jobs are getting created. So if you upskill and if you upskill as per the latest technology changes, this is going to be the good news. If you are not able to upskill, if you are not able to get into this this side, then it is going to be the bad news. Anyway, you guys started your career in data science. if you finish your journey in a successful way, this is going to be the good news. So, and as we also seen that India is going to the hub for all the future initiatives, because India is a kind of country where we have a lot of data is available, is there, because India has a lot of billion people, and everybody has, you know, has smartphones, and we are basically generating a lot of data. And other than that, also India is a potential for the huge skill. So most of the companies, most of the countries is looking towards India to start their projects, and they wanted to work with India. That is one of the great news. So that's why, you know, some of the industry bodies are clearly indicated that future is all going to be the data and the data-driven initiatives. Okay, that's why I said there is some GDP growth and everything is there. So it looks like the future is going to be the bright if you are going to work with the data, data-driven kind of solutions. And yeah, this is what the summary of the earlier slides. Analytics Insight predicted that, you know, we have like around 10 lakh jobs there in the artificial intelligence by end of. There are jobs, but yes, there is a huge potential gap is there, but there are jobs. So why all these sudden such a huge demand for data science? If you see, actually, this is some old slide. Before COVID also, people predict that, you know, digitalization is going to be the one of the key for the transformation. So before COVID also, people predicted that 85% of human transactions happen with the, you know, digitalization or some kind of digitalization or thing. But post COVID, I'm sure this figure must be accelerated to around 93-94%. So today, most of the transactions are happening in the digital nature, except eating and other things. But whatever you do, even healthcare, retail, transaction, education, even this session is also happening in the digital nature. So we are moving into the full digital, you know, era. We are digital. Now digitalization become new normal. It's nowhere any technology change. Everything is digitalization now. This is one of the reason. And second one is that if you see, there has been a lot of transformation in the happening in the customer experience. So earlier, most of the products are the provider centric. Now you take whether you are banking customer, even if you see your bank is providing, you wanted to get all your bank kind of information in your mobile phone, your hospital also, you wanted to access your blood reports in your mobile phone. And there has been huge customer experiences happening. There has been a lot of transformation is happening in the customer experience. In order to match this customer experience, all the companies need to build the product. You should go and serve the customer at the personalization level. That's why there is a need to build all kind of products. So these two are the most of the changes which basically changed the way we, you know, building the products. So now whatever domain you work for in future, your aim is to give the customer personalized solution. What is personalization? I will give a small example. When you open YouTube, if you see some video today, tomorrow if you open the video, you see the videos which related to your fast interest, whatever you watch it fast. So that's the customer experience. That's called personalization. So as a YouTube, it should give you only the videos which requires your, you know, which match your interest. So that's called the personalization. So I may get the different videos, you may get the different videos. How it's happening? It's the concept of personalization. Not only, you know, media, even everywhere the personalization is going to be the key. These two is basically changing the complete industry. So as I told you that, yeah, earlier, you know, the amount of time is taken is now taking only 2 months because of the COVID in the digital space. So digital shift is basically irreversible change, and it's basically accelerating a lot of data. By using this data, people are using various technologies and try to build various solutions which essentially go and serve the customers. So that's what the logic behind all the latest transformation. So that's why people will say data is oil, data is electricity. So behind all the scene is the data. I am not going fast, I think. Is this space is okay?
Yeah, students, can you?
Yeah, because, you know, as being students, I'm just asking these questions.
If yes, students, are you okay with it?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Digital, yeah, as I told you, that digital shift is the fundamental irreversible change. It is never going to be the, you know, now we can't go back to normal because we started this digital journey. I'm sure we will continue with this digital journey as and when it's possible. And it's going to the irreversible change. This digital shift is basically accelerating a lot of data in all the domains. And once it is the data, and we are using the technologies to prepare some kind of solutions, so that could be, you know, market research, intelligence, AI, all kind of intelligence we are providing from the data. It's for all the domains. It's not for any domain. If you see healthcare, now I actually works for a healthcare. My company is Mediva. We build a lot of healthcare products. Even earlier, healthcare is not transformed that much, but because of all this data now, telemedicine, EHRs, even all the domains, all the domains are using this digital transformation and try to provide the solution based on the data, like in healthcare, in the form of telemedicine, drug discovery. We see all we are able to find the drug for COVID is like 2 years. Earlier, it used to take the 10 years. So they have applied a lot of AI, ML behind it to understand the chemical reactions. It come out for the 2 years. That's how, you know, digitalization helps even for the drug discovery. Also, we'll discuss these in coming slides. Similarly, in the, you know, manufacturing, education, you know, most of the education is happening in virtually. Personalized education is going to be key in future, because we are getting the personalized videos, we are getting the personalized health, we are getting the personalized, products. Why can't we get the personalized education? People are working towards it. I'm sure in future, you will also see the personalized education. You know, everywhere, all the industries are basically getting transformed with this digital transformation. So yeah, some of the industries are already using retail, telecom, finance industries are already using, and some of the industries are in between, and some of the industries are even starting now. Even the industries like oils and gas, chemicals also started. So in future, whatever domain you are going to work, there is no getting out of working without data. So that's why you have to use the data science to provide the solution. So that's where it will move. So whatever domain, whether you go for retail, you go for healthcare, you go for banking domain, sports, oil, gas, chemicals, wherever you go, you need to use the data and try to provide the solutions to use the data. So that's what it is. So what? Why it's possible now? Because if you see the over few years, you know, the technology is evolving. So we are seeing like tools are evolving from past to future now. And even computation is also evolving from big computer to some nano computer. Even speed is also evolving. Some CPU, TPU, GPU. Now we see even sensor also evolving, sensors. Even the evolution of data also. Earlier we used to have mostly unstructured data. Now we have various sources of data. And the interfaces are also evolving. Like now we have conversational bots are there, voice bots are there, chat bots are. So a lot of these things are evolved over a time. It's not only evolved, internet, connectivity, IoT, algorithms, space, and all these are working together and individually and together. This has happened because of the technology change. All this making science fiction as reality. So you just see this video, how actually, you know, science fiction comes to a reality by seeing this video. Just 1 minute. 1 minute, Mera. I will just play this video. Mm-hmm. You just see how actually science fiction is becoming reality. Madam, you can see the video and audio. Please tell me, that's all.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Madam, audio is also coming?
Yes, sir.
I'm Saqib Sheikh. I lost my sight when I was 7. And shortly after that, I went to a school for the blind. And that's where I was introduced to talking computers, and that really opened up a whole new world of opportunities. I joined Microsoft 10 years ago as a software engineer. I love making things which improve people's lives. And one of the things I've always dreamt of since I was at university was this idea of something that could tell you at any moment what's going on around you.
I think it's a man jumping in the air doing a trick on a skateboard.
I teamed up with like-minded engineers to make an app which lets you know who and what is around you. It's based on top of the Microsoft Intelligence APIs, which makes it so much easier to make this kind of thing. The app runs on smartphones, but also on the pivot head smart glasses. When you're talking to a bigger group, sometimes you can talk and talk and there's no response and you think, is everyone listening really well, or are they half asleep? And you never know.
I see two faces, 40-year-old man with a beard looking surprised, 20-year-old woman looking happy.
The app can describe the general age and gender of the people around me and what their emotions are, which is incredible. One of the things that's most useful about the app is the ability to read out text.
Hello, good afternoon. Here's your menu.
Great, thank you. I can use the app on my phone to take a picture of the menu, and it's going to guide me on how to take that correct photo.
Move camera to the bottom right and away from the document.
And then it'll recognize the text. Read me the headings.
I see appetizers, salads, paninis, pizzas, pastas.
Years ago, this was science fiction. I never thought it would be something that you could actually do. But
so,
yeah, happy to say that we are also working on this face recognition using the emotion, sir.
So you know how many students are happy, how many
happy
students
and
are not.
How many are, yeah, we are working on this as an internship project.
So yeah, yes, man, it's nowhere, you know, it's nowhere science fiction, it's all reality. It's because now computers, as the algorithms also emerge, now we have data, because you have so many students, they can have like, you know, CC cameras, which can give lot of images, use the images and, you know, use the image and get. I will tell you one of the example, man. Recently, I went to ESI hospital.
Yes,
so
sir.
There actually I can see this tool is there, so they can easily see by face recognition of the patient, they can see how patient is happy or not in the ground. We never,
yes.
I really thrilled by seeing the technology they are using. I went to, because we works for a healthcare company, I saw this already, you know, transformed hospital. I saw attendance, everything we are seeing. So we need to use the technology, madam. I mean, people will say technology is there, but we need to use the technology in the right way. Maybe why you need biometrics? You have all the students' images through the, you know, image recognition. You can easily take the attendance.
We are doing that, sir. In fact, you know, to predict placements also.
Great, man. I will come and visit your place.
We would like to work with you also. Yes.
So yeah,
personalized learning also. We have just put a step forward.
Sure, madam, because every student is different, because
yes.
You can't have some broadcaster learning. See, 90% student and 35%, because every person is different. Somebody
yes.
Have abilities, somebody has leading abilities, somebody has learning abilities, somebody has thinking abilities.
Visual,
so,
yes.
Do the
yes.
Training as per their abilities, not everybody.
Yes.
So on the process, what we are, maybe we are killing some abilities.
Fresh
so,
passion, yeah.
Now, earlier we don't have technology, madam. Now we have technology. So use the technology and the young talent is there. See, earlier Microsoft only has this product. I'm sure lot of Indian startups has built this kind of, you know, the product which has seeing AI. I have seen lot of such kind of product, even lot of startups built. One of my friend is also working on this. This is really helping for the old people. If the oldest people, because they lose some kind of, you know, in Indian population, in India after 70 years, every person will have this kind of problem. So in our, you know, optical technology, if you invest this kind of small technologies where all it need to take the picture with the image captioning, it need to tell that, yeah, there is a bus, the bus is coming. It's very easy, madam. I mean, it's not that much difficult, correct? Anyway.
Yes, sir. Yes.
So because now computers can enable the images by using the computer vision technologies, computers can also understand the language by using natural language technologies, because there is a lot of translation tools, it's all possible, madam. Anyway, so yes, so that's what happening. But yeah, this is not the first time it is happening in the industry, I mean, in this history. So people will call industry 4.0, I will tell you the reason behind this. Till now the history has seen four this kind of industry revolutions, madam. The first revolution industry is called steam-based revolution, that was happened in 1784. When the steam-based revolution happened, we are able to find some trains and it basically, you know, change the complete the transportation system. The second industry revolution is electricity. When the electricity was found, it was, you know, wonderful revolution. With the electricity, we are able to find a lot of missions which basically reduce the human personal stress, physical stress. Then the computers, you know, computers, you know, IT is the third industry revolution. The fourth industry revolution, what people are calling industry 4.0, which is the combination of big data, AI, artificial intelligence, IoT, Internet of Things, which this industry revolution is basically a industry revolution which basically works with the data. So this industry revolution is completely different than all other industries, because in this industry revolution, the consumer is going to get more benefited. So because we are generating a lot of data, people are using this data and trying to provide the more personalized solution to the customers, which is going to help the customer. That's why this industry revolution is people will call consumer centric revolution. And in this revolution, the machines are not running by oil or not running by electricity, it's all running by data. So that's why this is called data industry revolution or industry 4.0. okay, so in this, because in this industry revolution we are able to create all the products by using the concept of artificial intelligence, because we are having so much of data. So we have so much of data, so much of computation power, so much of everything. This industry revolution, we are able to provide the solution by the concept of artificial intelligence. As I told you, the definition of artificial intelligence is basically creating an intelligent system which behaves some kind of, creating a system which behaves some kind of, which works with some kind of intelligence. So whenever you want to create such kind of systems, it has to be twofold. First, you need to understand the intelligence. So in order to understand the intelligence, as we have seen, the computers can also understand the images, languages, data, sensors. We will use a lot of statistical, machine learning and deep learning techniques to understand the intelligence. And once you understand the intelligence, we will create lot of products, lot of tools in the way we can create the products. That's where the world is moving. So whatever industry you are going to have, you need to understand the intelligence. That is the first part. So that's where your statistics and machine learning, deep learning skills comes into the picture. Once you understand the intelligence, you need to create them in some form of tools or web. That's where you can create the products. So that's what very high level it will work. So the full spectrum is AI. You will understand the intelligence by using machine learning. And if it's unstructured data, if it is like text data, then you are going to be the deep learning. Maybe once you reach the second semester, third semester, second year, third year, probably you will hear more about deep learning, natural language processing, computer vision. But as of now, you need to understand that machine learning, deep learning, and statistical techniques are going to useful to understand the intelligence from the data, are useful to find the intelligence from the data. Then we are using some kind of UI, UA kind of technology to create these kind of products using this intelligence. And the demand is there, as I told you that there's a huge demand. And so that's what overall thing. But behind all this is basically when you are understanding the intelligence, you need to call that as the analytics. So if you want to find something from the data, that you can call intelligence, that you can call analytics, different names. So let's see what is analytics, what is intelligence. So we have data. Can data can talk anything? Data never talk anything. Data itself, data is in silos. I mean, it never talk. Data cannot communicate anything its own. Yes. So we need to apply our knowledge on the data. The statistical knowledge, that could be the domain knowledge, that could be anything. We need to use our knowledge on the data and try to get some kind of insights and use that insight and do the action. So that's why if anybody asks what is ML, what is AL, what is DL, I can say it's basically data, knowledge, action. So you need to, so simple definition, whether it's the statistics or anything, data, knowledge, action, or hindsight information to foresight information. You have something in your hand and you know what about. From the data, what you know, you wanted to find, you don't know what from the data, that's called analytics. So hindsight information to foresight information. Simple, don't make any confusion. So that's what you are going to work. So in future, you are also given the lot of data. Then you need to apply your knowledge. That could be the domain knowledge. If you are working with healthcare, you need to apply your healthcare knowledge as well as your statistical, machine learning, deep learning knowledge, what you are going to learn in the next few years. Use that knowledge and try to get some kind of knowledge. Use that information and knowledge and try to get some kind of insights. Use that insight and get into the action. Create some kind of system which can help the patients better. Create some kind of, use the data and try to build a system which can go back and help the customers. That's what the role of the data science. So data, knowledge, action, or hindsight information to foresight information. You know what is your data is saying. From that, you need to find what you don't know about your data through some kind of model. So that's the simple definition. Yeah, as I told you that analysis is not new, it's there in the past also. But due to the time, I'm just earlier, most of the governments used to apply, every 10 years they used to collect the census data. From that, they used to build some of the policies, more of structured data. But what is happening off late, we are seeing huge transformation in the analytics because of these reasons. As I already indicated that digitalization is one of the key. And today we are seeing this era is the data explosion era. So why we are able to create such huge amount of data? People will say there are three reasons. One is like lot of unstructured data, social media. So now we are generating huge volumes of social media. And second one is your sensors getting a lot of data, like your number of devices to connect to the internet. So that's where we are generating a lot of data. Like in your college, you have a lot of sensors. Your phone has sensors. Everything is sensors, and we are able to generate a lot of data through the sensors. And third one is the memory devices are getting cheaper and cheaper. So we are able to store the enormous amount of the data. Earlier, if you want to buy, the amount of mobiles we are having right now, those kind of spaces, those kind of, used to be there in the airports. Now you see how they are coming such a cheaper and cheaper. And because of the sensor, the number of devices to the connect to the internet, and that they are throwing a lot of data. So that's why we are seeing a lot of growth in this data, growth in the data. And as for saying that earlier, people used to say that every 18 months, the data is getting doubled. Today, I have 100 GB data. Let's say after 18 months, it's going to the 200. After 36, it's going to the 400. So that's how the amount we are basically generating. That is the one of the change. And second one is, yes, you guys are in background, in a computer background, the big data, parallel computation, distribution computation is also came into the picture. Now we have a lot of parallel computation tools are there, Spark and a lot of other tools, and Hadoop, Spark. So now we don't need to, there is a, by concept of parallel computation, we can easily process the data, and with the GPUs and TPUs, we can easily increase the speed of the data. Processing, no problem. Data, no problem. Handling data is also no problem. Other than that, we are in the open source era. That means there has been a lot of core packages, tools available in the open source. And you don't need to buy any software in a lot of open source like Python or lot of open sources communities are there. They're also helping all these basically working together and making this industry is like very, very, interesting field. So that's what I'm saying. Behind all these things, this is what the data, and this is what the amount of data we are generating in 1 minute for the internet. So by the finishing the, by the time of finish the this session, imagine this into 60. That is what amount of data we are generating, and this is what the data. And every like now we have like 44 gigabytes of data. By 2020, end of the 2025, we are going to be like 163 gigabytes of the data. That's a huge data. 1 gigabyte equal to this many gigabytes. So you can imagine how much data it is. And I told you that the number of devices connect to the internet, even if your home also, your phone is connected to internet, your TV is connected to internet, your refrigerator is connected to internet, 3-4 kinds of phones, you are sharing a lot of data. Imagine how much data. So 50.1 billion, devices are connected to the internet. And the picture itself will show the memory, actually that is 2017. I need to change that. I will change it. It further, down the cost. So that's what, now we are into the 5G. So fast is also not a problem, everything is evolving. And why, what this evolution is make, this evolution is basically remove all the earlier barriers of infrastructure. Now, if somebody wanted to start the company or somebody wanted to build the companies, we don't have any infrastructure barrier because we have cloud and edge computing techniques are there. So there are a lot of people that you can give the space and computing power as a rental basis also, cloud and edge also. And earlier we have like data problem, now we are generating a lot of data. And now we have ability to solve the data also. So earlier we have like lot of, even though we have data, if you don't have algorithms, no. So now we have algorithms also emerged. Now we have computer vision algorithms. So through which we can handle all the images data, now videos data, and now we have like natural language processing. The computers can also understand the language. So you can build even computers can also understand the text and can give the product. So this is what happened. So as a student, I think by the finishing your, by the time of finish your course, still I think it will further evolve. If you want to come up with a nice idea, you can easily start up your own. So you guys have a chance to start your career as the entrepreneurs if you have nice thoughts and if you are willing to help the society. Because cloud is there, you don't need any infrastructure. Edge computing is there, you can easily get it, the cloud instances in very cheaply. And a lot of open source communities are there, a lot of algorithms are in open nature. So all you need to find the suitable problem and solve it. And yes, India is a country of billion people with billion problem. Maybe you can create some kind of solutions which can go and help the communities like agriculture, healthcare, education. So that's why most of the people will say AI is a social, social technique. I mean, because once you build any technology, if it is going to solve the common people problems like education, healthcare, and agriculture, so that technology is going to be the very great technology. If you see the artificial intelligence, AI, ML, it has that power. That's why people will say it has social good technologies. Okay, you can, if really wanted today, you can start, you can find some of the problems, so you can start building solutions towards it. Okay, you can predict the rain, so we can predict any insects in the fields, small snake bites, a lot of bites will happen. Can we find a tool which can, through a smartphone, it can easily scan the place and give some kind of indications about any insights? Possible, because now we can handle any, so that, such that you can easily find lot of solutions. So as I told you, that now computers can understand any kind of data. There is no understanding barrier. They can understand image data, they can understand text data, even they can understand everything. So that's where this is going to be the superpower. And I told you that even though we are generating a lot of sensor data, today if our parents are coming to a Uber, we can track them where they are. How it's possible? Because of the sensor data. And computer vision, we already having all our phones are have conversational chatbots. Now any company, they are trying to give services in the form of chatbots. Essentially what that means, that is going to be kill all the call center business. Earlier we used to have a lot of call center business. That's how it completely automated. Now nowhere we are seeing call center business, we are seeing only chatbot. Now all the companies started using the chatbot. As madam told you that you are already using face detection, that essentially work with the computer vision and virtual reality, lot of things you can do it. And similarly, text data, out of 100% growth, most of the text data is happening unstructured data. So that's why out of 100% data, 80% data is the text data. So that's why you need to learn more of deep learning technologies, like how to handle unstructured data, like which is like images, text, combination of these two. Even with that, computers can also understand the text data. Now we are able to see a lot of question and answer systems, sentiment analysis. Maybe in your college also you can try this small product. When the new kids are joined, they have a lot of questions. Why don't you create one chatbot? So they can ask any questions about your college. What is the library times? How do I find this document? Where should I pay the fee? So all these kind of things you can create in the form of chatbot and build it. This is the kind of some application too. Because it really helps the students. Any questions they can ask, they can give it. Similarly, chatbots, you can create all these products because the data is there, algorithm is there. All you need to find the data and build these kind of applications. As I told you, that chatbots are completely killing this business. See, 80% of now whatever website you open, first the chatbot will come. So this is what happening with in the name of artificial intelligence, with the deep learning, natural language processing, everywhere I think people are trying to provide the solutions. I will also show some of the use cases. And AI become now part of human lives. What to eat, what to see, what to buy, what to wear, everything is a part of human. So most of the human activities are now somehow augmenting by the AI. Today, if you want to watch something, yes, Netflix has recommendation system, Amazon has recommendation system. If you want to buy something, we have it. Even healthcare, what to watch, what to buy, what to go, where to stay, everything. Your Trivago actually has some kind of, if you go to new places, if you want to find your hotel, there are apps. So everything is become now, all the humans are basically augmented by the, intelligent systems like AI. So what does this mean? So this mean is basically, because of Industry 4.0, all these latest developments, whatever industry you are going to work, you need to work this, you need to build the product, you should have these kind of properties. Earlier, most of the products are reactive. Now people are building, you need to build the product, you should have proactive in nature, because you have the data, your model, your product should have these proactive capabilities. I will tell you how proactive. If you are going to work in a manufacturing company, you need to capture all the data in the manufacturing unit. Based on the trend, you are able to predict when the machine is going to fail. Because you already know when the machine is failed, you take the data and try to build the model and use that model in the production. So that's called all the models should be in the proactive. And earlier, most of the analytics are, you know, static. Now everything is dynamic. So if your parents are coming, we are able to track them on the real time. Your Google map is real. So whatever product you are going to build, that should have the real time capabilities. It's nowhere about volume. Nobody cares how much data it is. Everybody looks for the value. What is the value I am getting? And every product should be like intelligent in the nature, and everything is based on the evident based analysis. That's how, you know, it is going to be in the future. So based on all this technology, there is one other data strategist called Bennett Marr. He is basically shortlisted 20 technologies. If you want to Google his name, Google search his name. His name is Bennett Marr. He is basically shortlisted top 25 technologies, which is going to rule the world for the next 10 years. And essentially, all these technologies work with the data, data science, analysis, statistics, whatever you call. And these are those technologies: artificial intelligence and machine learning, Internet of Things, wearable technologies like smart watches, your smart lenses, big data, intelligent spaces like smart cities, smart hospitals, blockchains and cybersecurity, cloud and edge computing. Edge computing is basically wherever you are storing the data, you can do a manipulation there. By that, you can reduce the latency. Like if you are doing a surgery, you take the data somewhere, and if you need to go to somewhere and do the analysis, that will give some kind of latency delay in the response. By the concept of edge computing, now we are trying to reduce that thing. That's called latency. Extended reality, like augmented reality and extended reality, digital things, natural language processing, voice interfaces, computer vision, robots and cobots. I mean, robots already doing a lot of work. I think in the pandemic time, some hospitals are, you know, they built some kind of robots which can go and give the medicines because they touch the patients, because, you know, that's what is happening. Autonomous vehicles, 5G, genome is also happening. We are also working on this project to match the human genomes and try to understand something. Machine co-creativity, yes. Now machines can able to design the arts. They can also create the music. Digital platforms like LinkedIn, all those things, drones, cyber security, quantum computing. Remember this name, quantum computing is further changing the speed of the computation powers with the quantum concept, quantum physics concept, robotics process automation, 3D printing, nanotechnology. These are the essential 25 technologies which is going to rule the world next 10 years. And the common point behind all these technologies basically the works with the data and analysis. So that's what. So whatever you are going to work in your future, the product should be personalized, the product should have real-time analytical capability, the product should have proactive, and that product should have intelligent product. So no product is the IT product. Whatever product you are going to work now, they are all become analytical products. That's how the industry moves. Now I just wanted to 5 minutes gap, and I want to take the questions. Then we'll see the some of the quick applications and then go for the career. Now I'm stopping my share. If anybody has any questions, please ask me. I'm not going fast,
no? No, sir.
Anybody has any questions about AI, ML, all the technologies?
Students, please come forward and ask your...
It will be like more interactive because... Yeah, it
would be nice if you ask your questions that are in your mind. Anybody?
So if nobody has any questions, I feel that
you can go ahead and, because they're probably taking a little time to absorb.
I hope I am not giving, no, it's not fast, sir.
It is just
they need to be very happy, madam, because they are in the field.
Yes, sir.
You know, there is some saying, the kids who born after 2000, they are the lucky kids, madam, because they have everything in place, because they get
natives. Yeah.
They have everything in web. I think earlier, if the people wanted to find some information technology, it's very difficult to find it. Now they can find everything. So that's what everyone, the kids born after 2000, are they are really fortunate. All they need to use them in proper way and get benefits.
Yes. So now, my suggestion was at the end of this talk, we would like to announce maybe students coming up with any three problems that they think they can think of, where solutions, use cases kind, any problems that they have in mind being a student, especially in the context that since they have joined, it has been online. So anything that they would like to overcome, and we would like to use technology and AIML, like sir was saying, no, when the students first come in, we can have a chat box. Like that, if you have anything in mind where you think a problem can be solved, or you have a problem and you want it to be solved through AIML, we can have some prizes for the first three good problems that you can. We are only asking you to give problems.
Yeah, problems comes from you know this. So when you go to the college, if you don't find the where the information, then you get the panic. So problems comes from the panic. You find out if I go to library, I don't know whether whatever book I am searching is available or not. Can we create some kind of dashboard as soon as I enter to the library? If I go and see, is the book is available?
Yes.
How many such kind of books are available? Can I show it? If it is available, I will enter into the library. Otherwise, why?
Yes.
So you know all the books are there. You have the registries there. Get the register to Excel and take the data and create a nice dashboard. All you need to do is the student goes and search that book, and you will get a pop-up saying that out of 10 books, 7 books are taken by the student. There are 3. Help, na? That's madam.
So anything around you where you have a difficulty, it translates into a problem.
That can translate as a problem, and we have technology.
Solutions, we can find solutions.
You start that
so
as
we
a
can
problem.
Announce, yes, sir. We can announce any 3 good ones, and we can have some cash prizes today being a National Statistics Day.
Yeah. And one more thing, some Hindi medium, Hindi people will come, somebody comes from Telugu medium. Can we do some kind of language translation? It's possible. I mean, people are working, madam. It's not that much difficult because you have infrastructure in the colleges. You have labs, you have faculty. I mean, you have data.
Yes,
sir. All, yeah. See, we can do a lot of things, but you know, we are somehow restricted by our business clients and everything. We can't share their data. Some of our problem. But students, yes, you can get anything. You can do anything. Anyway.
Yes.
Now let's see some of the use cases. I think as I told you that these are all we are experiencing only. So most of the retail companies are using the big data, and they are trying to use targeting and upskilling, upsell and rescale. Like if you see here, if you go to any Amazon site, if you see here in the same ad, but we have 2 different kinds of advertising shown. Somebody can tell what is the reason behind it. Maybe the picture is not. The only difference between the 2 recommendations, because one page somebody is signed in, one page somebody is not signed in. So the page who are signed in, so what the system is throwing something, he is showing the advertisement based on his previous visit. That means that guy probably has searched something and watches in earlier visit, but didn't buy. But when it comes to the next time, as soon as he signed in, so it is showing recommendation and watches. So essentially what he's trying to do is he's trying to retargeting the customer. Correct, na? Maybe he can change his mind, maybe. So this is what it is trying to, the analytics companies are, the retail companies are using a recommendation system to retargeting and upskilling also. I'm sure we all bought things from Amazon and Flipkart. As soon as you buy something, you can also see the people like you also bought, or people also bought along with this along. This is all called recommendations. And you know, Amazon is getting around 30% of their profit is coming from, you know, recommendations. That's how, you know, people are using analytics in their business. Similarly, in the Facebook, all these people, basically Amazon, all these companies are using analytics for cross-selling, upselling, and forecasting also. In any company, you will get the loss in 2 ways. If somebody asks the things, and if you don't have stock, that is one loss. If you have stocks but nobody is asking, that is also loss. So you need to have a mechanism where you are able to understand the, you know, demand and able to forecast it and get ready with the stock. So that's where companies will use analytics and keep their, you know, ready. So these are all the problems we are using in the retail industry. As I told you, that cross sell and upsell, and that's where they can give the recommendation, will help the people. And this is one of the case study I want to tell you. This is what we built for one of our client, because now computers can also understand the images, computers can also understand the technology. So in the retail industry, we need to track the customer at the right place, at the right time, at the right offer, correct? That's the business. So we built this product for one of our company, but this is our product, that's why I'm telling. So what we have done is, now computers can also understand the images, we and sensors. So we basically installed a sensor in our shop, in a particular retail shop, because most of the customers have the mobile. So they basically download this app in their mobile. So as soon as the customer come close to my shop, through the sensor, I know that he is very close to my place. So I can trace his location. So I know that customer is very close to my shop, and I go to my, transactions. I see what all the customer bought earlier, and then I say, I will send a message to the customer. I know that you are very close to my shop, and last time you bought a Nike shoe. Now some offer is running on there. Why don't you come and visit? So what we are trying to do here, we are basically finding the customer at right location, at the right place, at the right time, and we are sending the, message also. That's how the retail industry is not doing. I'm sure you also get some kind of message when you are passing some of these places. That's how the retail companies are changing. So if the same thing, you can apply to your college also. If you want to understand how many people are actually there in the library, you can say how many people are there actually in this. So we can easily trace the location of your students by using their smartphones. All you need is the sensor to capture their signals. So once you are able to find the location of your student, you can find multiple applications. So like that, people are using these technologies. And this is one of the, to get some kind, this is one of the application in India. If you go to DMart, I know how much time you need to stand for checking, correct? So let's see how Amazon solving this problem with the concept of technology. This is what the latest retail application. You tell me, madam, whether I'm getting the sound and the video both are.
Yes, sir. It's coming, sir.
Okay. 4 years ago, we started to wonder, what would shopping look like if you could walk into a store, grab what you want, and just go? What if we could weave the most advanced machine learning, computer vision, and AI into the very fabric of a store so you never have to wait in line? No lines, no checkouts, no registers. Welcome to Amazon Go. Use the Amazon Go app to enter. Then put away your phone and start shopping. It's really that simple. Take whatever you like. Anything you pick up is automatically added to your virtual cart. If you change your mind about that cupcake, just put it back. Our technology will update your virtual cart automatically. So, how does it work? We used computer vision, deep learning algorithms, and sensor fusion, much like you'd find in self-driving cars. We call it Just Walk Out technology. Once you've got everything you want, you can just go. When you leave, our Just Walk Out technology adds up your virtual cart and charges your Amazon account. Your receipt is sent straight to the app, and you can keep going. Amazon Go. No lines, no checkout. No.
See how it will help the customers, madam, when it comes to... Hello?
Very, very true, sir. Very true. I think the students are excited about it. I hope so. Yeah, somebody's clapping. I can see virtual clap. Yeah, that's nice. They've appreciated, sir.
They must face the problem of standing so much time in the queue.
They must have faced. So many of them are clapping, sir.
So the problem is, these are all we can see in very soon in India also, madam. In the Kerala, they started. It will all come because we are able to do this because technology, see, earlier, the transaction used to be like 2 years, 3 years. If something happened in advanced countries, and it will take a lot of time to come to India. Now, yeah, because of globalization, technology, now it's coming in minutes. In fact, yes, we are doing a lot of advanced things than other countries. Now, people are taking from us because of our technology, this thing.
Absolutely, I think
so. There is no location. Yeah, there is no location, madam. There is nothing now.
No barriers.
World is a small piece, yeah.
Yes. I think they should be excited about all this. Really happy to see your...
No, man. So on the day of statistics day, if I motivate some of the students, then...
Just, yeah.
Yeah, now I will tell you another important healthcare industry which we are working, and actually we basically thought, why don't we transform human health, such a... Because health is above all the...
Wealth, so, yeah.
and somehow is a neglected industry, but now most people are working on it, and we are lucky to enough in that domain also. We have also very nice product I will show. Let's see. So as I told you that, you know, the other industry is the healthcare industry. So healthcare industry is one of the most important industry. So now data science is applying in healthcare industry, because if you are able to provide the personalized medicine, you know, every patient is different. Humans are different in terms of their physiology, their social, their health and everything. But, you know, somehow medicine is same. And the countries like in India, you know, madam, the most of the consultation time is like 2 minutes. Okay, if you go to the hospital, even if you waited for 1 hour, the doctor will spend you with 2 minutes, because of the improportion of the doctors and patients. That's not their problem, because India is such kind of country where you have lot of people.
Yes.
So where if the technology augment, no, that's where it's very helpful. And as for some of the statistics now, madam, the amount of time where doctors will take the decision is 30 minutes. That means if you're talking to the doctors around 30 to 40 minutes, by that time he already decided the medicine. Because that's the way they will operate. It's because of the India is heavy population country. So if technology can augment there, now that's where, you know, doctors will also get the time. If the technology will also helpful, that's where it will also patient. That's where healthcare is industry is one of the industry. So now we can also understand that the computers can also understand the images. Now lot of companies are building lot of radiology products, the products in the products by using images, which really help in the radiology, MR and scans. I know lot of startups are coming. They are really doing wonders. So even at the COVID time also, some companies just created some kind of product. As soon as they see your lung X-ray, they can detect whether you have COVID or not. So in future, I think radiologist has to see whether the machine given output is correct or not. The most of the, you know, radiology things are getting transformation by using the convolution neural networks and image recognition tools. It's not only that thing, man. If you wanted to really see the human brain scans, they are on the 3D print, and it's very difficult to understand even doctors also. That's where the products really make this case. Their MIT based students come up with a product which basically works like 100 times faster than the human interpretation. That's where it's going to transform with the CNN and all those things. And this is what I am talking about. One of the most important data is a neglected data is the healthcare data. You go to hospital today, you go some tests and the doctor will write something on the paper. If you go to home, it will go. So because now we are saying digitalization, so what we are basically, if you are able to, you know, put every patient data in electronic health record, you know what will happen with the data? We can try to really find lot of, we are able to find solution from the retail data, telecom data, bank data. Why can't we find some kind of this thing? Once it is captured data, it's all analytics. So that's what we started building some kind of this thing, madam. But we understand that, you know, there is no data. That's why we come up with a product called Mediva. Our company name is Mediva. It's a digital healthcare platform where we can digitalize the, you know, complete patient data and use the data. And on top of it, we build analytics. And as soon as the doctor is doing analysis, it will help the doctor to give some kind of, guidance. I will just demonstrate our product. This is what we are working. So really, if the doctor is getting augmented, because the third highest deaths are happening due to the medical errors also, madam, along with road accidents, other things also. But we are doing so much for road accidents, but nothing is happening. So once the data is captured in the digital, it will help the doctors. And doctors they will be augmented. It will help doctor to take the better decision. That's where we started this product. Our company name is Mediva, and actually we are looking for internships also, because there is a huge data. Anybody really want with the internship in your senior, anybody let us tell us, madam, we are open to the internship.
Yes,
there
yes.
are a lot of challenges to fail. I just demonstrate our product also, how Mediva is working on it.
In fact, we are also working at present with one problem. We'll take your guidance, sir.
Madam, you can hear voice and audio, madam?
Yes, sir.
There's the electronic health record that really cares about the value of real-world data for doctors and goes beyond just e-prescriptions, where while you are doing your normal consultations, the background AI and machine learning models convert all your clinical information into meaningful and analyzable data.
We understand that ease of use is important, and we are committed to providing doctors with a seamless experience so that entering patient data becomes easier than a handwritten prescription. Ranging from advanced link-based virtual clinic feature that lets you connect with your patients without any app, while you can observe their previous history and trends and make informed decisions even at a distance. Patients can share the link with their children or caregivers, who can also join in from any part of the world. Smart recommendations that match your clinical thoughts while you are consulting the patient. Easy to use templates that can save you a significant amount of time in adding detailed instructions for filling in the treatment plan quickly. Ability to choose from elegant prescription designs, which can further be customized. Ability to share the digital prescription with your patients via WhatsApp at a single click, and a lot more. We have for more than 10 years been working with global organizations handling billions of rows of data for their analytics needs. This is your inbuilt analytical dashboard and is an important first step where doctors told us that they lose a lot of time in what should be simple tasks like exploring your own real-world data, because these are interactive charts and can be used to define any group of characteristics like gender, age groups, and medication in this case. Every input is like a Lego piece available for reconstruction. This will help the doctor develop and explore hypothesis quickly.
So this is what we built for the doctors, and we already made the product in terms of, you know, doctor-patient interaction, madam. Only one thing is standard across the globe is the doctor-patient interaction. Wherever you go to doctors, the process is simple. You go with your vitals, ask the medical condition, take the, you know, tests and get the, you know, medical treatment. So what we have done is we basically made this product which can very useful for the doctors to, because doctors are not tech Greek. So what they used to apply this product, very simple. As soon as you enter the data on the back, AI and ML basically convert this data into data. Then on top of it, we build a lot of analytical solution which help the doctor to understand his practice more. How many such kind of medications works for what kind of patients, what treatment works, what treatment doesn't work. So by that you can take a better decision now, madam. That is one thing. Second, even patients will also have their track of the data. And anyway, tomorrow if I want to share this data to any doctor, I can just share by a click. And all the information exists in the digital format. We don't need to go for the duplicate tests. We don't need to go for duplicate, you know, blood test, all those kind of things. And other than that, these products can also help to trace the allergies, all medical mistakes, madam. That's what we are building this technology. And yes, there has a lot of opportunities are there. This product is using a lot of doctors. And the ultimately is basically we are able to create a system which can augment the doctor. We should behave like a doctor. That's the plan.
Wonderful.
So by that, what happened based on the person, we can basically get, you know, this person has this kind of background. Maybe this is not happening. Some of the problems, madam, even we also face in our families. Some medications cannot go with some kind of medications. As if people, we forget it, and that will also give some kind of reactions, some kind of, you know, allergic reactions, medical reactions. These are also causing some information. Somehow this information is stored digitally. We can eliminate these kind of things, madam. So all we are using the data and giving the insights.
Very nice, sir. Wonderful service to the nation. Yeah,
anybody, because it's not only nation and it's our product also. I mean, doctors are using it, and anybody wants to work, we are looking for the bright kids, obviously. So yes, and another product is the virtual assistants, because mobile apps, through the mobile apps, you know, we need to, what nurses generally will do, they need to remind the medications and go for the necessary tests. If you can create all this through your app, then basically it will, you know, with the, this keep on sending notifications as per times, and it's also possible. Okay, virtual nurses, and yeah, this is one of the latest thing. Now as we are using a lot of wearable technologies, now most of the clinicians and doctors and patients are able to monitor and track their healthcare data. Whenever they see some kind of abnormality, even hospitals are sending notification, and as a patient, as a person, you can also go and check and get the early detection. And robotic surgeries are already happening. So that's how the telemedicine is nowhere become a novelty, madam. It's become, you know, necessity.
Necessity.
Yeah, because I saw a lot of urban also. Yesterday we had a nice program in our Medivac platform. There's one doctor is really doing awesome work.
rural areas?
In rural areas, they are basically, we also, their EMR partners, Subodhan Trust, it's called Subodhan Trust. They started this telemedicine services in the rural area. So where actually, you know, this is all the community work, you know, doctors will be there from Hyderabad and help the patients in the rural area. And they will
especially
see
with COVID, sir. Yeah, with COVID,
COVID awareness. COVID, we did a project, madam, for the COVID isolation patients. We have seen isolation patients from Hyderabad and basically, you know, help them out to come out of the, you know, this thing. All happened technically from this location, madam. Yes. Anyway, that's how the healthcare is changing.
So
that telemedicine is nowhere novelty, and you can see your data, your self-exploration skills. I mean, you can see what data and you can get, you can see your heartbeat and you say that yes, something is happening to me. Yes, that's what happened.
To keep and fit also, yeah, to keep ourselves fit, you can count your calories daily, everything.
Yeah, everything, madam. Now you know how much time you are sleeping, how many steps you are walking. Essentially, okay. What? See, data cannot tell anything, madam. You know that how many steps you are walking. No? You should use that data and you need to find insights. No? That's where having data does not problem, madam. You know, I will anyway say, people will say data is like oil, data is electricity, but at a ground root level, data is like water, madam.
Water.
The world is full of water. 75% is surrounded by water. Still, we have drinking problem, na? Drinking water
yes.
problem. So, say same thing. Having data does not solve your problem. You need to have solve the solution.
Yes.
So, if you say Chennai is full of water, you know, Chennai is the water floods. We cannot say Chennai is the water-rich country, water-rich state. When it's in the floods. So that's what we know when we talk to the clients also, saying having data does not solve your problem. Having reliable data is the important. So creating the relevance from the data is one of the critical skills where people need to work in future. Anyway, so data is what
we have applause for your statement, sir. Most of the students are applauding you.
Yeah. Then we see some of the HR applications, but I'm sure I have some time because yeah, we are.
Students, we will continue for another 10 minutes, sir.
Yeah.
Because we can extend their lunch time. This is their lunch time from 12 to 12:40. We
okay,
can give them after this lunch break. So
okay.
Don't worry, students. Yeah. We will give you your sufficient time for your lunch.
Yeah. Or I can skip some of the slides, madam.
Yes, sir. Banking. Just a quick. Yes.
All, you know, banking, HR, complete HR is basically got, madam, because, you know, in your organization, if you want to recruit the 10 employees, you will get 1,000 CVs. You know, shortlisting the CVs is very difficult. Now there are a lot of natural language products are there, where they will take the job description and take all the CVs and do the text matching criteria, and based on the text matching, they will sort the top 10 candidates, see how much effort they are removing. Then they will use voice-based assistant chatbots for the first round of interview. About asking the education, all the details. When they join the company, also all the HR related policies they will understand by the text based chatbot. And when it comes to the training, also based on the knowledge and level, they can understand what all the training they need to undergo. When they are on the job, also by using the facial and other explanation, we can see how happy the customer, how happy he is in the job, and we can also predict how soon he can leave the company. Employee attrition also we can predict, madam. Those kind of products are there, and banking is one of the industry which can use a lot of this thing. Let's say if the person is using 5,000 on the credit card monthly, and suddenly if he made the 50,000, he will get the call. That's where the analytics will catch and help for the anomaly detection, all those things. And some of the applications is basically now, as we are using the computer IoT sensor data, now in China there is a project called City Brain, madam. They have installed a lot of sensors in all the roads of the traffic. As soon as the accident happened, all the traffic is rerouted such that, you know, the ambulance and police will reach the place quickly. That's how they are using. And through the face recognition techniques, I think in the airports also now this is started, madam. You can just go off, no checking. That's what people are getting, these kind of facilities. In future, we'll also get this kind of thing. NLP applications, Google is the place where we can get a lot of application. And this is what one product we built for one of our Zomato client. People will go to the restaurant, they will write the, you know, their feedback. As soon as we have the feedback, we have a system which can easily see how happy he is, and we can also understand the sentiment where he is exactly happy. Then the next time he comes, based on his ID, we can track and give the necessary services, madam. So
personalized.
Yeah, personalized. Everything is personalized, madam.
Everything
so now who is behind all this thing? he is the person called data scientist. There is no one such kind of person. He is like this person, like I'm sure this most people can create understand who is the data scientist from this this image. He is a famous detective.
Detective.
Can I tell you who is this man? Image.
What is that person's name? Anybody from your? I've just recently also I remembered his name.
Yeah, but tell me end of the session, madam. So we should have that kind of capability. So a data scientist like that person, it has not a single skill, but most of the people will say they're one person. But data skill is a evolution process because it requires the multiple skill sets. It requires computer science, math, statistics, domain knowledge, and visualization, storytelling capability. That's why data science is not a science; it's an art. It's an artistic job. So we need to have the multiple skills. That's why you need to learn most of the skills. So somebody from the statistics need to understand, computers, and somebody is from computer, you need to understand the statistics. Then only you become the data scientist. Otherwise, you will become silo in your respective field. That's why it requires a continuous evolution to learn other things, and that's where you will get all this kind of salary. But yeah, now we are coming to one of the most important thing: how to prepare career product.
Yes.
So now, if you want to become a data processing, these are the four steps you need to follow. Even it's for the student or even for the people like me also, it's very well required. You need to have knowledge on the tools. And one of the most important thing is the fundamental knowledge on mathematics and statistical concept. I'm telling the students, even if you're not able to understand till now, you need to understand this point. See, right now we are in the lot of auto ML era. A lot of tools are happening in automatic nature. There are lot of automatic ML, automatic DL tools are there. If you focus more on the tools and technology, and if you leave the cream of mathematics and statistics, computers backgrounds, then you are like become one of the, you know, see the only difference, in future you can find the good data scientist and bad data scientist is the data literacy. I'm telling you, you need to focus more on the concepts like mathematics and statistics and try to increase your data literacy skills, because most of the coding part, tools part is automated. So if I want to evaluate a person in future in the data science, I will evaluate on your mathematics and statistical concepts. So don't neglect your mathematics and statistics, even though you are in the BTech. Don't read that for the pass marks, because data science is basically learning and optimization. So if you want to learn, you need to understand all your algebra, optimization, you need the calculus. So you need your vectors, we need your matrix, we need your eigenvalues, eigenvectors, we need your, first order differential equation, we need your gradient descent algorithms, we need your concave optimization functions. So all are very important, because when you are working with the real time, you have to change these functions for the better answer. So that's why having strong mathematical knowledge, statistical knowledge is very much important. Please don't neglect that. So try to increase your data literacy skills. Create a portfolio, be in collaborative. Let's see all these things. So tools part, I don't give too much of priority, because there are a lot of tools are there. You know, learning tool is not important, but these are all the tools required to become a data scientist. If you want to handle the data, you need data handling tools, variety. We have like different databases, because big data, maybe if you can take one day, I will talk about what is big data, various components of big data, velocity of the data, and a lot of tools when it comes to the data visualization. We have some tools, finding insights by using some tools. And I told you that a lot of auto tools also, you don't. So that's why having tools knowledge is important, but having only tool knowledge is not only important, because if you treat the complete data science thing, the ML code is very small box. There's a bigger space out of it. That space I can call as fundamental knowledge and better data literacy skills, because data science is like art, data and science. You need to understand the data very well. As I told you, like data is like water. You need to create, energy from the water. That's why you need to make the relevance from the big data. So that's why you need to have this data literacy skills. When you will get the data literacy skills, when you have the strong mathematical and statistical skills. So the most important things are algebra. So Google come up with a verb to vec algorithm, which can handle the complete natural language processing, which is a vector algorithm. And matrix, all the data summarization techniques with your matrix decomposition techniques, like single value decomposition, then your
principal component.
Yeah, principal component analysis, L1, L2 norms. So everything is important. You need to be strong there. So even if I want to recruit, I stopped asking questions on Python and machine learning. I will ask what is L1 norm, what is L2 norm, what is eigenvalue, what is eigenvectors, or how you represent the lower higher dimensional data, lower dimensional data, and what is vector, what is directions. So those are, when it comes to the what is the first order, what is the chain rule of, what is gradient descent, what is so many things. One day I will talk about calculus also.
Yes,
I already done this last time, but yeah, you have wonderful faculties. I'm sure they will give you all. I know some of your faculty also, they are good at mathematics. Please focus those things and statistics. Yes, because you are working with the data, you are making sense from the data. You need to understand the statistics, whether it is significant or not, and you need to have data presentation or data dashboard skills, visualization skills, story skills. These are all makes you the data science. Then only you will get the so much dollar job. So data scientist is a creative person. So you need to start your career in one field and learn all the things. You need to be like multi-talented. You need to be more of a generalist. You need to have knowledge on, I am like data architect. Now I need to have a lot of, when I want to talk to data engineer, I will talk about in their language. Take the database, work with this Cassandra, then do this. When I go to statistician, I talk, use this model, apply principal component analysis, apply cluster analysis, use vector analysis. When I go to researcher, I will talk about your brand is not doing well. This is the problem. This is your KPO. When it comes to business person, I need to talk about business. So you need to have that kind of vocabulary. This will come through experience. This will come through reading a lot of applications along with. So you need to be like, I will tell you some of the qualifications required to become a data scientist also. And third one is the creating a portfolio. Now you guys are very lucky, as I told you, that after 2000 born. Now you need to create your own platform. How can you create a platform? There's a Kaggle is there. Kaggle is one of the place. Kaggle, lot of young talented data scientists come and solve problems for you. There has been some data, there has been application code, everything is there. Be part of Kaggle, see how people are doing, learn from their work, and try to share your knowledge. Create, participate in the Kaggle competition. While participating, you know how people are solving different problems, how people are finding COVID from the images, there is image problems, how people are using electronic health record data for the treatments, how people are using LinkedIn profile to shortlist the people. That's what, create a Kaggle and start creating your Git. Share your work, write the blogs. I have a blog called statsvenu.com. You need to also write and small things and go to meetups. You are in Hyderabad. Now actually a lot of virtual meetings are happening. Earlier we used to have a lot of physical, blog meetups happens in Triple IT Hub, IT Hub, and we have a lot of, I'm also personally conduct a lot of meetups in my company with the help of analytics, with other things. A lot of meetups will happen. Go and meet the people. I learned so many things by meeting the people. When you meet the people, he will give some suggestion. Go and be part of meetups. Attend a lot of virtual meetups. It will understand, you'll know how people are doing, how people are working. Learn from others' work. Because this industry is nowhere competitive. It's a collaborative. You cannot do all the things on your own. You need to work with a team and do it. So be part of meetups. And the one way is why I teach. I love teach because once I teach, I never forget. So today I teach this, so it will be there in my brain for next 6 months. By teaching will give you more familiarity. Teaching is a great art. If you try to teach, you give them more familiar. So this is how you can create your profile. Now people are recruiting on the people by seeing their Kaggle, by seeing their LinkedIn articles, they're seeing their GitHubs, they are recruiting. Before going to interviewer, we can assess how active you are or what is your profile, portfolio. Because I'm telling you guys, everybody is starting their journey in the data science like you in all the colleges. By the time you finish your course, imagine how many students come up with this kind of degree. So the only differentiation point is you need to have this kind of portfolios in your CV, then you will be attracted. Okay. And before going that, yes, because you are working with one of the dynamic data science industry, so you need to have this kind of job skill set. Once again, these are given by the Bennett Marr. He has given some of the skill set for the students. When I told you that data literacy, one of the most important thing, it will basically help how to use the data, how to extract the data, how to create the big data to relevant data, critical thinking. Because that's what tomorrow we need to solve. I mean, thinking is very important. Technology savviness. Today, the industry is changing. Today, we are having this software, these tools. Tomorrow, some more tools will come. So you need to able to adapt the technology quickly. You need to inculcate that habit. Adaptability, flexibility in learning. This is one of the most important, because data science is such a dynamic field. Even I myself learn so many, tools and packages. Every day we need to learn. So, and creativity, emotional intelligence. Today you work with one person sitting in India, one person sitting in UK, some one person in US. So emotionally you need to have intelligence, cultural differences, good leadership, because who knows, tomorrow you might work with the robot also, who knows, and collaborator rather than competitor, because it's a thing. You never solve one problem, you need to work with the domain people, you need to work with the analyst all. So you need to have more teamwork and collaborative skills, and you need to have a self-motivate, where you need to have a habit. If you wanted to become successful data science, I am telling you, it's not a single time effort. You need to put all your effort continuously, exponentially. So the code for data scientist is lifelong learning. I learn something and I can use it? No, that's for execution jobs, which is going to be automated. If you want to be on the cards, you always have to be ability to continuously learn and exponentially learning. And before closing my thing, I wanted to give one definition for the illiterate. The definition of illiterate in 2021 is that not the person who are not able to read and write, the person who is not able to upskill and reskill. That's where we are terming as a illiterate in our organizations. If your person is not able to upskill and reskill, even though he's the topper from MSCI, say now he's the illiterate. That's what the definitions are changing. Before I close this session, people are saying that a wonderful industry. Before 20 years, I think earlier people will say AI should, but now it's not should, it must. Any industry must have AI. And I told you that data is oil, but yeah, before the data is oil, it is water. It has to be clean, then only we can find the, we need to harness the data to get there before this. If any questions, I will answer. And yes, with that thing, I conclude my session. I hope I have given enough motivation to the students.
Sure, you know, please.
Because motivation is important with this, I think. So that's all I have, madam, on this great occasion of National Statistics Day.
Thank you, sir, so much. I'm sure it has motivated all of them and inspired all of them. And that was Sherlock Holmes, sir. I forgot his name for a moment.
Any of his novel, if you see any of his novel, anything, he solves his problem with some kind of incidents and evidence, madam. That's the skill everybody data should have. It's not like technology, it's like evidence. It's the how quickly you are solving problem, how it is going to help the customer. Ultimately, customer need to use the, solution and get help, madam. Even if you create such a huge, big, talented algorithm, if it is not helping the client, no use. Even if you are able to solve the problem in the small logic, that will help. That way the person should have this quality of solving problems through evidence. That's why you need to have that kind of skill, madam.
Self-motivation, I'm sure everybody should have it.
These students is getting into the world which is dynamic in nature, madam, because by the time they finish their course by next 5 years, imagine how the industry will change. So they need to ready to adopt all the changes. So as much as possible, they have to be part of all this, and they need to get motivated from industry and be, augment with the industry and learn the applications and get ready. It's not like, madam, even the cricket also, you show then you will be in the team. It's not like you go in the cricket team and then learn the cricket. Nobody will accept. You need to be an expert, then go, even for data science also. You need to become expert, then you will get an opportunity. You need to show that, then only you will be selected. And it's all possible because of the technology, data, and everything is there. All they need is the mentoring, madam. And today, one of the biggest problem is, because I will talk so much because this is what my...
No, it's okay, sir. It's okay. I think very rarely the students will get to hear.
The problem is today we have so much of information, man. I write so much on my blogs. Go and check statsvenu.com. Today we are having a lot of data, madam. Content is there, but connection is not there. So we need a person who can give the connection between the content and context. Okay, so that's where you need to find your mentors in the industry. They should come and give some kind of connection between the content and this thing. And when it is the content also, the problem is there has been a lot of content, madam. So there is a saying, instead of reading 40 bad books, if you read one good book, it will give knowledge. So you need to find the good content also. So if you go and open internet, you will get a lot of content. People will get lost or what to read, where to read. So you need to find the suitable content also. So
that is what we are trying to do, sir, as teachers, since there are so many resources available, we try to go through them and give them the best.
Yes, that's what. Otherwise, they will lost students because...
Yeah, they'll be lost.
Yeah, because they come... Yeah, sure, madam. Anyway, thank you, and students, all the best. I'm sure...
Students, any questions, you can always feel free, and we can connect you to sir in case you have more questions in future.
I have my own website called statsvenu.com.
I put it in the chat box. They can reply and talk to you.
Yes, anytime I will.